Good morning, everyone. We are going to be using a polling tool during the session today. It's completely optional, but you can use your phone to text message if you want, and the details for doing that, you can do this first poll as a warm-up, and that will get you set up with the system. You can also do it in your browser if you want to. So if you want to text, you're going to text OCLC to 22333, and then you can respond to the poll using A, B, C, D, or E, and you can also put that in your browser, pollev.com/OCLC. It's just a way to do some engagement today. We can hear a little bit from you and incorporate that into the presentation. So thanks for joining us this morning. This is the OCLC research update. We do have a poll going, completely optional. If you want to, you can participate via text. You'll send OCLC to the number 22333, and that will allow you to join the session, and it'll keep you joined for the entire session this morning. We just want to learn a little bit more about how all of you are engaging in partnerships and collaborations. We'll incorporate a bit of that into the presentation today. And we'll be getting started in just a few minutes. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. My name is Kendra Morgan, and I am I'm the director of WebJunction programs, and it's great to have you all here today to join us for the OCLC research update. We started by asking you all to participate in an optional poll, just looking at how you are all collaborating and partnering with folks. A few of you don't have any active partnerships or collaborations right now. Some of you have done so many that you've lost count. I know that it really depends on where we are working, what we're doing, what our responsibilities are, but it's great to see the level of engagement and how you all are thinking. Our session today is on partnering with purpose for greater impact. And I'm joined by my colleagues, Lynn Silipini-Conaway, who is the Executive Director of Research, and Dennis Massey, who is a Senior Program Officer with the OCLC Research Library Partnership. We're really appreciative of your time today, and it's going to give us a chance to explore a little bit more about how OCLC Research partners for impact, what we are hearing from the library community and how that surfaces in our research. And we want to be able to share some of that with you. And so much of what we are going to be talking about today can be found freely available through the OCLC research website. So we do encourage you to check that out. All of the reports that we're going to be talking about, the resources, you'll be able to find that within the OCLC research website. So we do have a lot to share this morning, so we'll get right into it. And I'll kick things off by mentioning a recent report by our OCLC colleague, Brian Lavoie. He published this report last August, and it even has collaboration in the title. It clearly is part of the focus that we have been taking at OCLC, is to not only leverage our own partnerships, but to find out how these are impacting libraries and the work that they do. The report that Brian did really looked at the options for exploring and acquiring capacity within academic libraries. And in this context, we're talking about capacity as obtaining something that extends a library's ability to deliver value to its users, such as experiences, expertise, services, and infrastructure. And a key part of sourcing that capacity is really, it's a strategic choice that we're going to collaborate in ways that serves the needs of the library and its users. And we look at that collaboration as really being a key part of our work in the past, in the present, and the future, and that it's a strategic decision. It's something that libraries are having to choose to do among other alternatives that they may have. And then we have to manage these collaborations, right? It's one of the things that prevents people from entering into partnerships or collaborations is that there truly is a level of effort that comes with it when you introduce more people, more organizations into the work. In the framework that Brian describes, he looks at the sourcing options as really being four key pathways. And the first is that we can build the capacity within our own institutions, right? Being able to develop and deploy that capacity through internal efforts. So we do it within our own organization. The next is that we can collaborate. And that's working collectively with a group of organizations to create and sustain capacity. And then the next on the continuum is if we have to outsource it, right? Are we working or contracting with an external provider to supply capacity? And that's the key part of that step, is if we're going externally and we're outsourcing, that's a completely different way to be able to acquire that capacity. And then finally, there's referring. So when we can't provide the resources, we don't have the capacity or strategic priority to collaborate on it, we might be doing a referral. So really just directing users to external providers when there is no contractual relationship. So we know that this organization is doing something really well and it can meet the needs that our users have. And aside from providing a link or direction, we really may not do a lot of effort with that sourcing option. So we're curious, and you can use the poll is what factors have impacted your decision to source capacity within your institution? And again, you can use this if you are watching the stream at home or in your office. You can use pollev.com/OCLC. You can also text your responses in to 22333, and you'll type in OCLC, and once you've done that, you'll be able to add your own contributions and type things in, and they'll start streaming up, and we can all see where people are standing. So factors that have impacted people's decision to source capacity have included staffing, right? When we have limited staffing, we may seek other users or other organizations to help support us. Funding, if we have limited funding, that may be a really key reason that restricts our ability to collaborate with other institutions. In that case, referring may really be the strength that we can rely on. And that one's definitely coming up a lot, right? It's one of the biggest constraints that we're faced in our work. The types of projects that we're working on, I'm gonna share some resources that our WebJunction team has been working on that really depend on subject matter experts in the field. And without partnering, we wouldn't be able to do the work that we do. People power, right? That staffing, that ability to pull in subject matter expertise. Our mission, that's another really important one to consider. Can we achieve our mission more effectively through the power of partnership? The ability to support each other and not overlap efforts. I think one of the most common statements that I hear in the library field is not reinventing the wheel, right? How can we rely on what other people are doing and surface that in our work and learn and capitalize on what they need? All right, thank you for sharing those. So one of the things that Brian shares is that sourcing options or sourcing choices are not made in a vacuum, but in a complex environment shaped by dynamic factors that influence which sourcing consideration a library prioritizes. And this is a really important factor, right? We have to think strategically about what we're choosing, how we're choosing to pursue different opportunities, and when it makes the most sense to do that. And I encourage you to check out the report. It's got some great details and a framework that can help put some of this into consideration and think about the impacts to your organization. I'm going to turn it over to Lynn.
Thanks, Kendra, and thank you all for joining us today. I appreciate it on this last day and in the morning. And what I'm going to talk about is some work we've done with Global Council. So there was a survey, and it was called this whole area Redefining the Library Experience. And in this survey, it was a takeoff of what we learned from a project that was New Model Library. And in the New Model Library, we had three themes that came up. We interviewed 29 library leaders from different types of libraries, as well as from different parts around the world. And so the three themes that emerged were engagement experiences, work experiences, and collections experiences. So we picked up on that for this survey to find out more about what was happening with these areas, not just with collaboration, but in general. But what came up was were partnerships and collaboration. And so the survey has been completed. We've almost finished analysis, but you know, there's always room for more. And we're hoping to, planning to have a summary of our findings next month. But so you're getting some preview of what we will be sharing with the public. Also, we have been interviewing public library leaders, so directors, middle managers, and frontline staff to talk about some of the issues of importance to them. We looked at the literature, then we started developing the discussion questions, then we developed the focus group interview questions. So this is a combination of all. They're all starting to blur in my head. I'm going to try to tell you, well, this was from this survey, but it may not work that way. And so this actually did come from the Global Council survey. And so this survey was distributed in 5 languages in addition to English. And so this was something new for us at this capacity, at this level. And we had almost 2,000 responses. And so we had to translate all of the open-ended responses as well. And so these are the things that came up. The benefits of partnership. So you can see it's that the opportunity to listen and learn. And I love the listen part because we often forget that. The sharing, provide training and materials, supporting these vulnerable communities. And we heard that a lot in all of these areas. Facilitate access within the community, and then to help reach new audiences. I always ask, are you just concerned about the people who, in your communities, whether they're academic or public, who use your libraries, who use what you're offering, or do you care about those, and I call them prospective users, not non-users, prospective users. Do you care about them? Yes, I have always heard, yes, we do care about them. One thing that I've been hearing and that I actually love is that don't partner just to partner. Partner because it's really going to benefit the library and the library's community. And some of the library leaders will say, well, some of the staff get upset because they say, no, we need to partner. People want to partner with us. Yes, but what is it for us? What's in it for us? And you always have to remember that. And also that referral. Sometimes we just can't do everything. So be able to refer individuals to other services. Now, this came from the New Model Library individual interviews and from the focus group interviews that we're doing now. And again, it is this revive existing partnership post-COVID. And we've heard that a lot, that there were partnerships pre-COVID, and then there were partnerships during COVID. Some of them sustained, some of them did not. And then there were partnerships post-COVID. And often, there was this need to revive those partnerships that were developed pre-COVID. Also, think about new programs and offerings based on community needs. Again, what is needed in this community? What are the needs, the expectations? And then coordinate an integrated response to the community need. And then again, align complementary services. And I can't say this enough, but you have to assess and evaluate. And some things have to go away, and then you can have new things and new partnerships. And I know that's hard. I have a hard time throwing away anything, but you have to do it. And now with the Global Council area focus, we have done this now for several years, so I'm just giving you a little background. We looked at the global resource sharing, and that was in 2018, and this is really appropriate because today Dennis is going to talk about a lot of this resource sharing. We had an open content study in 2019. We heard a lot in the New Model Library interviews about open content and partnering with publishers, library consortia, other organizations for open content. And we are still hearing that in our current focus group interviews. This whole global perspective on discovery and fulfillment, there are a lot about the terminologies we use, the way we present information, our algorithms, All of this has been coming up. And again, partnering with others who provide these systems or services for us or with us. We also you looked at the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And that's something that is very important. I remember when we first did this, someone said, what do libraries have to do with sustainable development goals? Who cares? Libraries have a lot to do with sustainable development goals. And again, that partnership is part of that. And a little plug, we just had a paper about that, libraries and the sustainable development goals, published in the IFLA journal. And then libraries as an open ecosystem was another one. So space, in the new model library, we came up with space as a service. And sometimes I don't like to use the word service, and I like to say offering. So, but it sounds better as space as a service. And you can see this is a quote from one of the respondents in the Global Council survey, and talking about this destination of the library and where the focus is more on spaces and personal communications. And there was a lot of talk about place maker spaces, places for design. There are a couple that will come up. I better wait, so they're a surprise. But so this was one. This is another one for the space as a service. Again, less print, and that's where all of this open access, digitization, digital divide, all of those things come up, and we can't do much without partnering with others. And this was, I thought, was interesting. They don't need, you know, all these high-tech things for their spaces. They want them to be flexible so we can change, again, with these expectations and needs of the individuals. So these were some of the results. Again, we haven't published this yet. It will be out next month. So you can see from this that this area of service, of space as a service, was really one of the trends in this this study. And overall, 59% of our total respondents expect collaborative meeting spaces to increase in the next 5 to 10 years. And so this means there are spaces for people to congregate, communicate. There was a public library in Denver where the individuals, it was a Hispanic community, and there were carols in the library, and no one was using the library, and they were going to close the library. And so they did a community analysis and realized that this community wanted to sit together. They wanted to play in the library. They wanted an outdoor space. And so they changed that, and it became much more a part of the community. And when you would go to this library, they're outside, they're playing ball, they're inside playing ball, they're laughing, they're yelling, they're eating. And that is what the community wanted. It was this collaborative community space. And now I'm going to move on to resource sharing. So this is a quote, again, from our survey that hasn't been disseminated yet, the results. And they talk about this library consortia. They have the shared catalog, they have shared physical resources, but they also collaborate in many ways. So training, sharing. One of the things we heard a lot from library leaders in these focus group interviews, and either as well as frontline and middle managers, is this is great to talk to each other, to hear that we are going through the same things. We have the same challenges, we have the same opportunities, and again, this collaboration, and they have new colleagues. My mother always said, misery loves company. And so it's really nice to have others with you, and you can talk about the solutions. So for the resource sharing, these are the results that we came up with in the survey. And again, 59% of the total respondents expect to increase resource sharing through consortia. And then there were different aspects of partnering, as we all know. And so some of them talked about partnering with for-profit services in the community. And this one was with a telecommunications company. We heard some with companies that provided computers and laptops and hotspots. So we heard a lot about the for-profit collaborations. Also, different cultural sectors. So they worked with different churches and really looked at ways of collaborating with it to help the community. Again, going back to the mission. And then this was interesting. A variety of types of businesses were mentioned. So there were restaurants, bars, coffee shops, salons. I almost said saloons, but that did not come up. Bookshops, health organizations, banks, senior living facilities, content providers, vendors, publishers, cultural associations. But then when you see 47% of academic respondents currently do not offer and do not plan to partner with for-profit services, and that surprised me. 28% of public library respondents expect to increase their partnerships with for-profit services. So that's a little different here in the responses. And this is just a quote from a public librarian in Canada about partnering with nonprofit services and government agencies. And again, public schools, daycares, health centers. And this is another quote. This is from a public librarian in the US about partnering with food banks. And I loved another quote about partnering with a food bank and how individuals felt much better walking into the library for the food than into a food bank because of being stigmatized. And that doesn't mean that the library was the provider of the food, that the library partnered with them. And then these were the results of partnering with nonprofit services and government agencies. So nearly half of the public library respondents expect to partner with nonprofits and government agencies. And so that was something as well. It's this whole public library area. And this is the quote from a director of an urban public library in Canada. And that whole stigmatism, and the library is this friendly, open, maybe welcoming place. And this is a quote from one of our focus group interviews about providing training, facilitating access, and reaching new audiences. And I love this. This individual said, talent knows no economic or any boundaries. The only boundaries are financial. And this individual was saying the people in the community could not afford to have lessons, for music lessons, for their children. And now the library is that place. And that they have paper keyboards and things that they can take home to practice. And some partnerships can be a relatively easy lift, as we know, and they can bring really big benefits to the library. And this is one that brought a huge benefit to the library. And as you can see, it was high school students coming to learn how to cook in a kitchen with chefs. And some of them then, they were hired and either some in the library catering service or in some of the restaurants. So providing these opportunities. Someone on the, in one of our, researcher in one of our focus group interviews said, you know, we really need to advocate for a place at the table. And this individual was very adamant about that. And he said that often librarians are struggling to vocalize, to have a voice, and that that's where we really need to be helping individuals with this partnering. And this is one more that I really liked. It's become a member of the community. So we don't want to just be seen as a building with books. And we all know, when you talk to people often, when I'll say I'm a librarian, they'll go, oh, you check out books. Are there still libraries? Do people need them? And we need and want to be more than that, and we are. We want to be seen as a community member and partner. And this quote is from a director from an urban public library in the U.S. And, you know, talking about how we need to communicate with each other, with our partners, and with our communities. And I've used this many times in many presentations. This is a white paper that was written in 2012. That was a while ago. However, I don't think that this ever gets old, and it's Brian Matthews. By focusing on relationship building instead of service excellence, organizations can uncover new needs and be in a position to make a stronger impact. And I think we really need to remember that. We often are worried about failure, and there's that fear then to innovate. But it's okay to fail if you've learned something. And I just saw a t-shirt here that had something similar to that. And so it's okay to fail. Just learn from that and share with others so that they know the challenges you faced and how you move forward. So thank you so much. And I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Dennis.
Thank you, Lynn. I don't know if I should read anything into the fact that the last thing you said before turning it over to me was, it's okay to fail. I'll assume that.
But not for me.
Not for me, okay. Everybody, thanks for being here. It's great to see you, those in the room, and if you're watching from home or office, delighted you can spend this time with us today. So I'm going to take a look at three different examples of partnering with purpose. Each example originated from a very different mindset, and as we all know, partnerships come in many shapes and sizes. They can be full of surprises, and they can change drastically midway. I'll quickly mention that when I was originally asked to do this presentation, I misheard the assignment, and I got excited because I thought it was partner with purpose. I'm not going to say I'm disappointed that it's purpose, but you know, it is kind of fun to kind of think about what might have been. So partner with purpose it is. So okay, there we go. My first example would be a research project that began as a fairly circumscribed investigation of how art libraries might identify likely partners and create mutually beneficial partnerships around managing print collections. And that was a project that expanded in scope and took on a real sense of urgency with the onset of the pandemic. The second example is a resource sharing consortium that I've managed for about 25 years, where the pandemic pushed me to bring the group together in ways that previously I wouldn't have thought would have worked at all, but that turned out to be kind of magical. And the third example will be a partnership that was a grand undertaking from the very beginning, focusing on a sensitive and high-stakes topic that concerns every library in the library community, and happily an effort that's already seen significant impact on the community. So those are my three. Let's begin with a research project called Operationalizing the Art Research Collective Collection, which is quite a mouthful, and that's why it's known as OPART for short. This quote from an article by three OCLC research colleagues. You see, Brian Lavoie's got his fingerprints all over our presentations today. Here he is again. Sums up the underpinnings of the OpArt project pretty succinctly. A collective collection, no matter the scale or geographic context, is something that can be circumscribed in library data, quantified, analyzed, which in turn supplies valuable intelligence in support of local collection management as well as new forms of library collaboration. So the spark for the OpArt project came from a conversation that I had with four art museum librarians and one academic art librarian way back in 2019. It was mostly about space issues, specifically the difficulties art libraries are having finding partners where they can work on managing shared print collections together, how to go about establishing partnerships with them that are mutually beneficial, even if they find someone they'd like to partner with. So these librarians were also concerned about the lack of knowledge about what their peers were collecting and whether or not it might be possible to cut down on redundancies and maybe pair up with someone who has a complementary collection. So we saw that we had the beginnings of a research project after that conversation. And originally we thought we might do a case study of a successful partnership that one of the art librarians was part of. And then because most library partnerships happen regionally, we thought we might also do some collections analysis of what art research materials are held and by whom in a particular region to see if any libraries there seemed like they might be natural partners. But then the pandemic happened, and with all the attendant disruption, hardship, and uncertainty, art libraries, like all libraries, were severely impacted, but especially art museum libraries, because they're so heavily dependent on people coming into their parent institutions, like physically showing up. They really depend on that revenue to even exist. So the sustainability of art libraries really was called into question, as was the sustainability, which is really hard for me to say this morning for some reason, sustainability of the Art Research Collective Collection. So the OpArt project took on a real sense of urgency because of that, and the scope was expanded, and we got some financial support from the Crest Foundation, and we partnered with a really stellar advisory group of eight art librarians from member institutions of the OCLC Research Library Partnership, and we embarked upon this two-year investigation using a mixed methods approach with the goal that you see stated right there that you've been staring at for the last 5 minutes. Well, he yammered through all that. First came the quantitative analysis. So remember, we were going to look at a small region. Well, we ended up looking at a big region. We looked at the US and Canada. And our advisory board helped us identify 85 art libraries in the US and Canada of various types that catalog under their own OCLC symbol. So we could use WorldCat data to really parse that out. And the aggregated holdings of those libraries stood in as a proxy for the Art Research Collective Collection. We analyzed the heck out of that collection. Mostly Brian Lavoie again. There he is. This should be the Brian Lavoie show. You think? So yeah, Brian really looked at subject, format, age, language, how widely held it was within the group, how widely held it was outside the group. Then we got some World Share Interlibrary Loan data, and that's where I came in. We got that for the proxy group libraries. It wasn't all 85, I think it was 50 that actually used World Share ILL. So then we were able to track how this collective collection was shared over a 5-year period and with whom, how often, and so forth. So, and as we know, resource sharing is in itself a form of partnering with purpose. On a separate track, we did our qualitative analysis, conducting three case studies of existing partnerships. Each partnership represented a different model of collaboration. So here our advisory board really came through for us. Two of the case studies actually involved their institutions. They were very brave to raise their hands and say, analyze us a lot. And having these art library experts stand behind the work and publicly communicate the value of it to their peers brought a lot of interest to the work, and that's what brought us our third case study, which we wouldn't have known about at all if someone came up to us at a presentation about the data analysis part, and that ended up being our third case study. Our advisors also helped convince the non-art library partners in all three case studies to speak really candidly with us about their specific partnering experiences. So it was essential to have not only the support, but they fueled all of this work, the library community experts. So we end up producing two reports, because that's what we do. They're both freely available. They have really pretty covers. You can get these on our website. There's a link there, but if you Google, I guarantee you, if you Google operationalizing art research, you're going to find it. One of the reports uses data to demonstrate the value that art library collections contribute to partnerships and to the overall collective collection. And the other delving into what makes for a successful, mutually beneficial partnership between libraries. While the project focused on art libraries specifically, the conclusions, particularly of the second report, can apply to any sort of library partnership. And in many ways, OCLC Research's partnership with our advisory board of art library experts could also be serve as a case study about how to successfully partner with purpose. So today's session is part of a series called News You Can Use, and in that spirit, I encourage you to get your hands on a copy of the case studies report. I could talk for an hour about this slide. In fact, there is a webinar that you can find on the project website where we talk for an hour about these recommendations. In just a few pages in the report, we walk through these recommendations for effective partnering with context and examples from the actual case studies. And if you're interested in library collaboration, I think you'll find the report useful and thought-provoking. So our community experts provide us with a roadmap and a deep sense of purpose. And this project started out really modestly, but soon right-sized itself to the proper scope to adequately address the size of the topic. That's a lot of words. Come on, advance. I'm stuck here for some reason. Here we go. All right, so now for our second example, the Shears Resource Sharing Consortium. Is anyone using this bottle of water? Because I need it really badly. Pardon me one moment while I imbibe. Shares Resource Sharing Consortium. So Shares is a resource sharing consortium for members of the OCLC Research Library Partnership. And its membership reflects the profile of the RLP cohort. And that makes Shares a somewhat unusual ILO consortium because there's quite a mix of sizes and types of libraries, and then they're spread all across the Western world. So you don't see that in a lot of resource sharing consortia. Almost all the members in Shares are also members of multiple other consortia, so it's a real meeting of the minds where they bring information back from what they're doing in other consortia, and stuff from Shares goes out to them. So not only ILO materials are being shared, but you know all the things that are going on pretty much everywhere gets brought together and discussed. That's a big part of it. Shares has been around for over 40 years, and I've been managing it myself for 25 of those years. So there's a long tradition of collaboratively addressing challenges and trying new ways of sharing, whether by creating a new tool, like we built a thing where you can find out what your ILO unit costs are, or for developing protocols for sharing special collections responsibly. So a long, long history of collaborating. And the group has long interacted, particularly before the pandemic, via listservs. I know. A lot of in-person events we used to have, like regional meetings and stuff, back when people traveled a lot. And also, when working groups, we had conference calls, just with audio. So that's how we'd get together. And if 4 years ago you told me what Shears really needed to do was have weekly town halls where we just open up a meeting room and come together and just talk and do that every week, whole year long, I would have said you were nuts. I would have really resisted that. I would say, who would come to such a thing? Who would spend that time? Who would show up? And what would I do with the information? How would I ever find time to like summarize that stuff and get it out to the people who couldn't come? So that shows you how much I know. Then the pandemic happened. Lots of my stories have that part where then the pandemic happened. Pretty much everyone was in lockdown, as we all remember. Most ILO operations couldn't even access their systems remotely. They hadn't figured out how to do that because they never needed to. And how in the world were these ILO units continue to function? Because there was still demand as teaching and learning went online. there's still folks who needed stuff. So how was this going to even happen? Was it the end of the world as we know it? On March 26, 2020, pretty early along, I convened a Sheriff's Town Hall just because there seemed to be a need for folks to get together and talk. So just opened up a WebEx room, didn't have any agenda, just show up, let's talk things over. So, and the idea was let's support each other, share information, create workarounds, just be in the moment together. And 36 people showed up, we had a great conversation. I did find time to do a summary and a recording, and we were off and running. And so for months we did two of these a week, one at different times so that different people in the shares, because you know, we're across all those time zones, have people in Egypt, have people in California. We did two a week and as many as 50 people would show up because what else did they have to do? Everybody's at home and really freaking out. So some of these sessions got people cried and got really emotional and comforted each other. There was really a lot of gallows humor. There was like a separate conversation going on in chat that was hilarious. Often I didn't get the full effect until I went to write the summary. It was like, oh, that's what was going on, okay. We talked about whatever was on people's minds and I kept putting those summaries together. I began compiling them into one document so people could do keyword searches and so forth. We started blogging about it and getting the word out. So much great information and tips started coming in. We started inventing our own workarounds, some of them that spread out into the whole ILO community because some of the things we needed to track, our software didn't track. There was all kinds of new things to keep track of, like, yeah, this library can fill scans, this library can scan from print. This library can send you books. We never had to track that kind of stuff before. So we came up with a lot of workarounds and our working group suddenly popped up that synthesized that and we started like publishing FAQs. There's one there for like the highlights of the first 25 town halls. So we started sharing this information. We did that primarily to share the information in a synthesized way, but also so we could share it beyond shares. We just put that out and published it so anyone could have access to what we were learning and discussing. And it's also kind of like a little snapshot in time. Now it's like a little time capsule of what we were doing and thinking about back in those days. Around the same time, Peter Collins was hired as OCLC's Director of Resource Sharing. Peter hit the ground running. Like, he literally started when the pandemic started. And that was super challenging for him. He provided a lot of outreach to the community. I remember he put together a WebEx of his own for the whole ILO community, where like over 1,000 people came and started sharing their workarounds and so forth. But Peter came from a shares library, so he knew shares and was comfortable and started coming to our town halls too. And he would he quickly discovered that it was a kind of a safe place for him to try out new ideas and get feedback. So he started using it as a sort of focus group in a way. So that was cool. So amazing things started to happen. People who had never met started collaborating because they would have conversations at these town halls. Two fellows at different institutions discovered they each had cheat sheets about ways to order from overseas suppliers, really obscure places that weren't on any automated network. They combined the cheat sheets and then started like doing data mining of their ILIA databases and then inviting other people to contribute. We put up a thing that had a forum where you could send your own stuff in. It turned into this thing called the International ILO Toolkit that it has like 250 entries in it now, countries all over the world, including US suppliers too. And now we even developed language templates. So if you wanted to send an email ILO request for a copy or a loan in 10 different languages. So it became this amazing crowdsourced tool that's still growing, new updates every week. So that came out of the town halls. Two other fellows who had never met discovered they had a shared passion for providing ILO materials to patrons in accessible formats, folks who don't see or can't hear or you know, different things. So they created a detailed resource document covering topics like, excuse me a second. So good. Copyright, best practice, technology, and where you could find resources of all kinds. And we made that available to everybody, not just shares. Soon after that, we found out the US ILO code was going to be revised, and it doesn't say anything about accessibility. So we took that document as a starting point, and then we devoted several consecutive town halls to crafting language that would fit into the ILO code about accessibility, defining what it is and laying out what the rights and responsibilities are. And all of that got picked up. The final version has just been released in the last couple of months, and all of that language got in. So now accessibility is in the US ILO code because of what happened at these town halls. Let's see what else. I think I had more to say about that. What was it? I went away too fast. What did I want to say about chairs? The thing I learned from that was I was glad I was wrong. Like, I would have never done that, but it turned out that the things I was spending my time on weren't nearly as impactful as what I ended up, like, having those town halls, just making a space for people to come together and be around each other to give them the opportunity to eventually build up the trust and the relationships and sharing the ideas. It took a lot, many iterations, but then suddenly collaboration happened. So I was delighted to be wrong. And we're still having them. We just had number 167 the other day. So I still get about, you know, once people went back into the library, we didn't get 50 anymore, but I get 20 every week, and we still do them. So it's pretty cool. A lot of new faces and voices. All right, that's what I wanted to say about it. Okay, last but not least, God, I better hurry up. You have to talk too, don't you? I'll stop. Okay, last but not least, my third example, partnering with a purpose, is around reimagining descriptive workflows, a project that I wasn't involved with, but that I watched unfold with profound respect and admiration. So the library community is acknowledging and grappling with the impact of racist and harmful terms that have been used in vocabularies that describe library resources. The Mellon-funded Reimagined Descriptive Workflows project included work with several partners, a committed advisory board, and community experts who participated in this multi-day convening in the summer of 2021. The major output of the project is a report published in 2022, authored by my RLP teammates, Rachel Frick and Marilee Prophet. The report serves as a community-informed agenda, and I'm reading this because I didn't have anything to do with this project, so I'm reading it. It's a community-informed agenda for reparative and inclusive descriptive practice that builds upon the 2021 community convening, as well as examples of work underway to radically reimagine how descriptive metadata work happens. The report provides paths forward for description that address historic harms and omissions, in part by including thoughtful and respectfully engaged community participation in the powerful processes of naming, with the goal, for example, of having people from whom collections originate represented using terminology that they use to describe themselves. So this project was a massive undertaking, assembling the group of investigators, facilitators, and community experts, and then building the trust so that the work could be done was a monumental task. So I take my hat off to all the folks who worked on this project. So last slide, I promise. This is where, so I had my three examples of partnering with purpose. One began modestly and grew in response to the urgency of the situation. One that was forced on the participants, including me, by a catastrophic event, but ended up being something that had lasting positive impact. And one example that from the beginning was a grand undertaking of enormous significance. So thank you for listening. Sorry if I squeezed your time. I'm turning things over to my pal Kendra.
So the next section that we want to cover are some of the projects that have come out of WebJunction's collaborative efforts with the library community. And these are mostly focused in the public library sphere, but they absolutely have implications and benefits and value to other library types as well. So the first is the Libraries Respond to the Opioid Crisis Project. And this is something that we started doing research on back in 2018. And we're continuing to do this work in a new toolkit, support kit, that's going to be coming out later this summer, that's helping to provide library staff with concrete steps that they can take to respond to the opioid crisis in their communities. This is work that was sponsored by the Institute of Museum and Library Services, and we originated the work in partnership with the Public Library Association. And a really key part of that first project was looking at the importance of libraries partnering with community experts, community organizations, health departments. And the reason that we undertook this work, back in 2017 when we started, the number of opioid overdose deaths was 130 deaths per day, which was really staggering then. It has since increased as a result of the pandemic to 218 people per day in this country. This is a really staggering number, and it's impacting our libraries very frequently people are having issues with behavior in the library. It's happening on library grounds. It's impacting our communities, our family members, our coworkers. So we undertook this work and have continued, we're now in the fourth year of providing a different range of resources to help libraries in this response. What we found through the research were four key reasons that libraries were partnering. And the first was to amplify, right? They were working with local organizations to amplify collective efforts to respond to the opioid crisis. The next was to leverage. They were looking at using a partner's resources or assets to strengthen the program or initiative or even make it possible. Often we can't even do something if we don't have a partner, right? Going back to that capacity issue that is in the other report on collaboration, we don't have the capacity to do it, so we can leverage the strengths that other organizations are bringing. And then we're able to expand, right, to work in an area or topic that is unfamiliar. I didn't come into this project with expertise on the opioid crisis, but I was able to build my knowledge and build my expertise through consultation with subject matter experts in the field, and we hear that a lot from libraries as well. And finally, it's to develop, right, looking at relationships that can be activated for future issues or projects. Maybe something won't come out of that initial conversation, but people are gaining traction and having those initial conversations with people to see how they might be able to be successful or engage in projects in the future. So some of the programs and services that we learned that libraries were offering, and these were all through partnerships. They were doing naloxone training with both the staff and the patrons. They were bringing in community authors or authors to have talks and community book reads. Peer navigator programs is one that has definitely benefited from local partnerships. And so this is when individuals who often have subject matter expertise or lived experience with issues including experiencing homelessness, substance use disorder, are coming in and providing support to patrons in the libraries, which is a huge capacity improvement for public library staff who are often finding themselves answering social services questions or trying to connect people with resources. And these peer navigators and even social workers at times are coming into the library and helping to fill some of this capacity. And that is a major partnership opportunity that we've heard is really beneficial to libraries. And it's something that can happen in libraries and communities of all sizes. We've also heard about mental health and substance use related health programming. Not surprisingly, some of the most common partners that people are working with in these instances are health departments. One of the things that Lynn mentioned was the concern that often comes up with other types of organizations around stigma, right? That people may feel stigmatized walking into a health department asking for assistance. They often don't feel that in a public library, right? They feel like that's a welcoming and safe space. We know that libraries are seen as both accessible and trustworthy by the community. And so having a place where they can walk in and grab pamphlets, get information, sometimes get a dose of naloxone or Narcan, which can help revive people after an overdose. The library is one of the places that is accessible to people in a way that the health department may not be. With Recovery Court, this was an organization in Tennessee that works to provide an alternative to prison sentences. And the library partnered with this organization to do training. So they were doing life skills training on resume building, how to, you know, shopping, food, nutrition, all of these things that were really impactful to their life outside and helping to improve the quality of their lives. And the third type of partner that we saw were nonprofit organizations, so those peer navigators that I talked about. One of the things that I want to emphasize about this and that importance of partnering with purpose, and it also surfaced in the research that Lynn was doing, is that these partners are often not thinking of libraries as an access point to your patrons, to your users. they just, it doesn't come top of mind. I think when we talk about how libraries serve the communities, books are top of mind to people. And sometimes we have to be able to get out there, make the connection, and tell people just what libraries are able to do and how we're able to connect, because these organizations don't necessarily think of it. But what we did hear from all of the research was that all of the partners would want to partner with the library again. They found it really beneficial. The quality of the relationship that they had, how they were able to build that with staff, was really beneficial to them and their work. A second project that was really collaborative for us was on digital collection stewardship. And this has resulted in a series of 7 free on-demand courses that help small public and tribal libraries, archives, and museums with creating digital collections. This work evolved from another partnership that we did back in 2017 with the Digital Public Library of America and the chief officers of state library agencies around how digital collections are being handled in our smallest of libraries. We learned that over 92% of small libraries had digital or had collections. They just weren't able to digitize them because of capacity concerns, training concerns. And so we were able to start a partnership with the Washington State University and Dr. Kimberly Kristen, who has been a guest speaker with OCLC, and she was also running the Center for Digital Scholarship and Curation. And they had a digital stewardship cohort program, but that training program was really only impacting a small number of students. So we worked together to bring together a course series that hits on 5 different topics around the digital stewardship lifecycle that can be accessed and used by anyone, anywhere. This is a really unique design because the partnership that we had to incorporate the voices from small tribal archive and library museums and looking at some of the unique perspectives that these organizations bring. This was a really collaborative approach, and so our partnership, this was critical. We didn't have the subject matter expertise, that capacity, right? That especially working with tribal archives, libraries, and museums, we needed that to come from somewhere else. We have deep expertise in building continuing education and helping to connect adult learners to content that's helpful, but we didn't have the subject matter. So for us, that capacity came with partnering. All right. So we want to make sure that you know you can stay in touch with us. We have blogs, we have newsletters, we have guest speaker series, webinars. These are all freely available through the OCLC research site. We do encourage you to sign up to receive the newsletters. It's one way that you can stay informed about what's happening outside of these annual updates. This work is truly powered by our relationships with the library community, and we encourage you to reach out to let us know how we can support you. And we do have a few minutes. If anyone has a question, if you could please go to this microphone over here to my left. We'd love to hear from you and learn a little bit more about how we can connect with you in the future. Thank you for your time. Any questions? Well, Lynn and Dennis and I will be up here. Feel free to come up. We'd love to talk to you, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference, everybody. Thank you.